Hallelujah. Our glorious families. Amen. Tell your neighbor and say, you will see the glory of God. Proverbs chapter number 3 and verse 35. And by the way, the neighbor that we are referring to is sitting next to you there at home. And those who are here working and serving, they are sitting next to neighbors. Amen. So at home, if you are sitting next to your child or your aunt or your spouse, just tell them, you know, you will see the glory of the Lord. Proverbs chapter number 3 and verse number 35. Proverbs 3 and verse 35. The wise shall inherit glory, but shame shall be the legacy of fools. My God. The wise shall inherit glory. I want to be one of those who will inherit the glory. Amen. And then it says, but shame shall be the legacy of fools. May foolishness be far away from me. Amen. And take note, I love it when the Bible chooses terms, you know, specifically. The Bible does not say, and those who are stupid, right? It says fools. Hallelujah. It says shame shall be their legacy. Father, we thank you for the reading of your word this morning. Bless us in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's look at the glory of God and our families. The glory of God and our families. We looked at our lives and the glory. We looked at the church and the glory. And today we are looking at our families and the glory. I want to start off by saying every family is especially regarded by God as the sphere of his glory. Amen. God wants his glory to be revealed in and through our families. Alibongwe igama lenkosi bazalwane. And not only that, but God wants also our families to experience this glory. Are we here? I love what the Bible says in the book of Zechariah, chapter number 12 and verse 7. And I'm just going to paraphrase because of time. But there, the Bible specifically makes mention of the glory of the house of David. Or it refers to the family of David as a glorious family. Are we here, Bazalwan? In verse number 7 and in verse number 8 of Zechariah, chapter number 12. And of course, as I said, this is not just about God, you know, demonstrating his glory, but also God wants us to experience this glory. He wants us to experience in our families his glorious presence, his power, his prosperity. So in other words, God wants to bless us in our families. Amen. God wants to favor us. God wants to use us. He wants to prosper us. He wants us to succeed as families so that his glory may be displayed to this whole world. Are we together? You know, Joseph spoke about his success when he was in Egypt and he referred to it as his glory. Amen. So God also wants us as families to speak, you know, of our success and prosperity as our glory. Amen. So that's why our families are supposed to be glorious families. Are we together, Bazalwane? So God, therefore, wants to turn each and every man into a father of glory in his family. A source of glory in the family. Are we here? Amen. God himself, Bazalwane, refers to himself as the father of glory. And we are his family. We are his household. Are we here? And when he looks at himself in line with us as his church, as his family, he says he is the father of glory. Are we here? He says he is the father of glory. In other words, he is the source of this glory that we are talking about. So if we are going to experience his glory in our lives, it is because it comes from him as our Father. If we are going to experience his glory in the church, it's because it comes from him as our Father. Are we here? So he then says in Ephesians 1 verse 17, the Bible describes him as the Father of glory. Are we here? And I love it because, you know, in Jeremiah 7 and verse 18, and this is where, you know, the significance of fathers come in. And we are also going to see how, in the context of a family, how God brings families together for a specific purpose. In other words, a family is not just supposed to live together, but there is a plan and there is a purpose that God has. Amen. There are certain things that we are supposed to achieve as a family. There are certain things that God wants to bring about here on earth through our families. In Jeremiah 7 verse 18, listen to what the Bible says. It says, the children gather wood, their fathers kindle the fire, and women knead the dough. And this has got nothing to do with, you know, saying the only responsibility here of a woman is to be in the kitchen. That has got nothing to do with that. Amen. But it shows how in families we are supposed to work and function as a team. There is a role that the children will play. There is a role that the father will play. There is a role that the mother will play. And of course, I am talking here in the context of an ideal family. Amen. So all of us, we come together so that we can bring in a certain aspect, a certain element in our family, so that the glory of God will be displayed in and through our lives. Are we here, Bazalwan? And again, you know, the Bible draws a very beautiful picture here in the life of Solomon and David. And it shows us how, you know, David as a father gathered resources so that the temple may be built. And we know that David, you know, had a desire in his heart. He had a dream in his heart to build God a house. But we know at some point, you know, God did not allow him to do so, but it was that responsibility or that assignment was given to his son, Solomon. But David made it his responsibility to gather all the resources so that Solomon will not have to struggle to build this house that David wanted him to build, or God wanted him to build. Are we here? Amen. So our God then is a generational God. That's why in the Bible, you know, he is revealed as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Because when God does something, he is looking at what he wants to do in terms of, you know, long-term assignments. Are we here, Bazalwan? In Genesis 17 and verse 7, the Bible says, and I will establish my covenant between me and you. He was talking to Abraham. And your descendants after you. So let me say this, that when God saves you, if you are a first-generation Christian in your life, know this, that God is not just looking at you, but he is looking at your descendants. He is looking at your children. He is looking at your children's children. Amen. He is not just looking at your generation, but he is looking at a generation after you and the generation after that generation. Are we here, Bazalwan? That's why then the Bible says again in Acts chapter number 2, verse 37. This was after Peter, you know, preached. The Holy Spirit came down and Peter started to preach. And the Bible says in verse 37, now when they heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? Verse 38, then Peter said to them, repent and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. But take note of verse 39. Then it says, for the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call. So God saves this particular generation, but he makes it very clear. He says, this promise of salvation and the gift of the Holy Spirit is not just for you. So in other words, even us as this generation, we need to understand, especially, I'm going to say it again, if you are the first generation Christian in your family, you need to understand that God is not just looking at you here. So you need not to just think about yourself and what you can get from God. You need to have the very same mindset. As a matter of fact, even though you are a second or a third third generation Christian, you need to understand that it is not just about you. God is looking at your seed. God is looking at the generations after you. He wants to impact generations. God does not have to start from scratch with every generation. And He is counting on us to serve not only our generation, but the next generation. Are we together, Bazalwane? So take note then that God will always use families to touch generations. In Ephesians 3 verse 21, the Bible says, to Him be glory in the church by Christ Jesus. And then He says, to all generations. So when God brings you to Christ, He wants you to encounter His glory. But His aim, it is to even release this glory to generations, not just you as an individual. But God is always thinking generations. Remember I said, that's why He's regarded as the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And when He was talking to Abraham, He was talking to him, referring also to his descendants, those who are going to come after him. So in other words, we need to come out of this mindset and mentality of me, myself, and I, to think that God only has an assignment for you as an individual. You need to think of your family as a person. So you might be sitting here and you are saying to me, no, Mfundisi, but me now I'm not married. This message is not relevant for me. Believe you me, it is very much relevant, because you need to have this mindset so that by the time you get married, so that by the time you have a family, you need to understand that it's not just about you getting married. It's not just about you having children, but it's about God having a plan and a purpose. And God wants to touch generations. God wants to touch nations. And He is going to use your family to do that. So in other words, I have got to fight for my family. I have got to stand in the gap for my family. I have got to avail it to God so that God can use it. Let me actually say this. Your family stands a better chance of survival if you make it available to God to use it for generations. Because God has no business saving your family if it does not serve Him. If it does not serve His agenda, if it does not serve His plans and purposes. So when you are praying for your family, standing in the gap for your family, you need to understand that God will not intervene just to fulfill your own motives and agenda. Oh God, I want this for my children. Once you start praying for your family, at some point you need to let go of what God wants to do with your children. Because sometimes we pray for them because we want God to do what we want. We pray for our families because we want God to do what we want with our families. But once we begin to pray for our families, we need to understand that we have got to step aside and allow God to come in and do whatever it is that He wants to do. I'm sure all of us, Bazalwane, we do have some form of plan and agenda that has got nothing to do with God and His kingdom. All of us, Magnatiwa Snigezu Tu Baktiwe Namklanje, do not even think about the kingdom of God. Do not even think about God. Just say what you want. I'm sure all of us, we are going to talk about beautiful houses, beautiful cars, money, living a good life, and that's all we are thinking. And that's why many of us, after we have made that money, after we have lived in those houses, after we've driven those cars, and we die, and then that's it. And then the book of Ecclesiastes calls it vanity of vanities. But once we bring our families to God, God then looks at generations. God makes your family and its name to be relevant, not just in this generation, but even in the generations to come. Amen. We are not going to be talking about the children of Israel today if it were not for Abraham. Abraham, who gave birth to Isaac, Isaac to Jacob. Jacob, who changed his name and become. So when God was busy with Abraham, He had the nation of Israel in mind. Are we here? I hope I will finish today, but I doubt already. So how does then God function in terms of our family? The first thing that we need to understand is that when God brings us together, husband and wife, and even though you are single, one day God will bless you with a wife or with a husband. And you need to understand that when God brings you together, He has a plan in mind. He has a purpose in mind. And how does he do that? God starts by making you conscious of the fact that he wants to give you children. And not just children, but and their children as well. Let me read this scripture and help you out. Because I'm sure many of you in Ngqondo seziyazula manje. Psalm 127 and verse 3. Take note of this scripture and take note of it very carefully. Behold, children are a heritage from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. If you read that scripture just in passing, you will miss a lot from it. Let me take it step by step. Number one, children, it says, are a heritage from the Lord. Maybe before I emphasize this point, it's good to believe God for children because the Bible says the fruit of your womb is a reward from God. So it's good for you to believe God for your own children, right? But do so with an open mind. Because sometimes God, like I said earlier, whenever we are praying to God, we are not praying to dictate to him what he must do. Sometimes we need to pray with an open mind and listen to him, because prayer is not about telling God what to do. Prayer is also about hearing from God, Bazalwane. That's why in the book of Ecclesiastes, the Bible says God is in heaven, right? And we are on earth. So when we come before him, we must not bring a sacrifice of fools. The Bible says we must come to listen instead of speaking. But the first part of that scripture says, children are a heritage from the Lord. What is a heritage? It is just simply an inheritance, something that is left behind for you. Again, the Bible says, children are a heritage from the Lord. Children are a heritage from the Lord. Let's do this. God says, he is a father of the fatherless. The Bible says children are a heritage from the Lord. It does not have to be your biological children. Okay, you have missed it. It does not have to be your biological children. Children are a heritage. So God has got a heritage of children all over the world. And if you come to him asking for a child, God can give you a child any day. And if he rewards you with the fruit of your womb, so be it. It's your portion and God will bless you. But if not, children are a heritage from the Lord. God has got an inheritance for his own children, because when he says, I am the father of the fatherless, he is in heaven. But he is looking for a father in one of you here to take his place, in the same way that Jesus is our shepherd, but he is sitting in heaven and he has appointed shepherds here on earth to stand in his place. So God then says, when you come together, think children. Because the only way I can touch generations, it is because it is only when you are thinking children. Because there's something that must come from you. There's a glory that must come from you into them. And from them into their children. And from their children into their children. And from their children into their children. But for as long as you don't have that mindset, you think this marriage thing was just for you to be happy, to be taken care of, to have somebody who can hug you, to have somebody who can kiss you, to have somebody who can buy you this, to have got somebody who can cook for you, whatever the case may be, then you have missed it. Listen. Because we are talking about the glory of our families here. Then Proverbs chapter number 17 and verse 6, clause B says, the glory of the children is their father. So in other words, children are depending on their father. Let me even put it this way. They are depending on their parents for the glory. That's why I said earlier, there is a glory that must come from you to the children. Are we here? So in other words, we owe it to our children to pursue our glorious destinies. We owe it to our children to actually live glorious lives before them. we owe it to our children to become part of a glorious church together with them, because there is a glory that must move from us to them, because the Bible says the glory of their children, of the children, is their fathers or their parents. Let's put it like that. Amen. Lest I be accused of. And then the Bible says again, Proverbs 20 verse 29, the glory of a young man is their strength, and the splendor of the old man is the gray head. Love this scripture so much, because if we read both of these scriptures together, side by side, the one that I've read earlier, the glory of the children is their father, and this one, the glory of the young man is his strength. So in other words, every child depends on their own strength. There is a dangerous combination here, that I'm gonna work hard, and this is where, you know, even when things did not go well with your parents, God still says, I have given you strength as my child. I have given you strength as my, just as my born again child who is born again filled with the Holy Spirit. I have given you strength to use it to produce glory in your life. But then when there is a parent in place with glory, then the combination of the glory produced by your strength and also the glory that is left by your parent as a legacy for you. Ah, Bazalwane, I'm not sure if you understand. Then you are well positioned as a child, as a son, as a daughter in that family, so that you can live a glorious life and experience the glory of God in your life, and experience the glory of God even in your family, and experience the glory of the Lord even in this whole world, and contribute towards the display of the splendor and the beauty of God in all the earth. Amen. Are we here? Amen. But then he moves from our children. Not only does he give us our children, then he gives us our children's children. Remember, I said, God is the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So when God deals with Abraham, he deals with him not to a level of Isaac, but to a level of Jacob. I was alone. I don't understand. So when God says the thief comes not to steal, to kill, or to destroy, but I have come, Jesus says, that you may have life and have it more abundantly. So the abundance is not for me. So God fills my life for me, but he gives me abundance for my children and for my children's children. I'm not sure if you know what I am talking about. So by the time I'm experiencing overflow, I'm supposed to be thinking my children. I'm supposed to be thinking my children's children. Are we here? So God wants to give you the kind of blessing, the kind of favor, the kind of wealth that is not just going to make your life better, but the kind of life that is going to make the life of your children better and their children's better as well. So he gives us grandchildren. Proverbs 17 verse 6, clause A this time. It says, children's children are the crown of old men. So as you grow and you understand your assignment for your children, that God crowns you with your children's children. Underline, it does not have to be your biological children. But as a matter of fact, I'm tempted to say, once you raise any child as your own and they become a heritage that you have received from God, their children become your children's children. And the Bible says he crowns us with grandchildren. And David in Psalm chapter number 8 says, when I consider the heavens, everything that you have created, and I look at this man and I'm asking, what is man that you are so mindful of him? Why are you giving us so much attention as men? But then he finishes off that statement by saying, you have crowned him with glory. But in the book of Proverbs, he says he crowns us with. No, so in other words, this glory is not for you. This glory is for your children's children. Crowns us with glory. Glory that we are supposed to experience. Glory that is supposed to increase and abound. Glory that is supposed to extend to our children. Glory that is supposed to extend to their children, Bazalwane. Listen, that's why then in Genesis 15 verse 5, the Bible says, talking about Abraham, it says, then he brought him outside and said, Look now toward heaven and count the stars if you are able to number them. And he said to him, so shall your descendants be. Underline, not all of them are connected by blood to Abraham. We are also considered the children of Abraham through faith in Jesus Christ. But God shows him the stars, says, count them. And if you are able to count them, that is going to be the number of your descendants. But 1 Corinthians 15 verse 41 tells us that stars have glory. And it tells us that the one star differs from another star in glory. So in other words, there is a Gloria Kwamsipha that is not the same as a Gloria Kwamtsuhi. But all of us, we are supposed to be carrying the glory of God and transfer it to generations after us. And all of them are supposed to display a certain aspect of the splendor and the beauty of God, a certain element of the power of God, because it depends on what kind of a grace corner we see, what kind of a grace corner we see. But all of us, we have our own glory. And that glory is supposed to be transferred from one family to the next. Are we here? And then it says in Proverbs 13 and verse 22, a good man leaves an inheritance to his children's children. Underline, not just to his children. He leaves a good inheritance. Good inheritance. He leaves an inheritance to his children's children. But the wealth of the sinner is stored up for the righteous. But this inheritance can only be accessed by the wise children and the wise grandchildren. Because there is no sober parent who wants to leave an inheritance for foolish sons, for foolish daughters who are going to waste their legacy. That's why it cannot be limited by our biological children. But anyone who wants access to this glory or to this inheritance. So the scripture that we have read then in the beginning says, the wise shall inherit glory. So our assignment then is to impart wisdom to our children, wisdom to our generation, so that they can be wise enough to inherit the glory that we have pursued, the glory that we have experienced, the glory that we have seen, so that whatever experience we have had with God, they are not going to miss it. They are going to partake of it. They are going to have access to it. Are we here, Bazalwane? But it says, but shame shall be the legacy of fools. That word legacy there is room, R-U-W-M, in the Hebrew, and it means to rise or to raise. It means to bring up or to exalt. So in other words, if we want to raise the next generation, if we want to bring promotion to the next generation, we must be in a position to raise them up, to be wise, so that they can partake of this heritage called glory. Look, we might not leave cars behind. We might not leave houses behind. But at least we must leave glory behind. We must leave glory behind. And they are going to be set up for promotion, for rising up. They are going to be set up to do better than us. They are going to be set up to take this nation to the next level. They are going to be set up to take the work of God to the next level. In other words, if you have done business up to a certain point, and for some reason God calls your children for business as well, they are supposed to be functioning in business at a certain level because of the kind of legacy of glory that you have left behind, Bazalwane. So there has got to be some form of glory that each and every one of our families is going to produce. I have said it earlier and I'm going to say it again. You might be listening to me and saying, Mfundisi, I'm not married. You are not talking to me today. I am talking to you. God is, as a matter of fact, I'm so happy for you that you are hearing this message before you get married, so that by the time you get married, you will understand what is it that God wants for you. So in other words, as this generation, we are supposed to have this mindset that we are here to build a legacy of glory. We are here to raise up a glorious family. We are here to position our family for glory, for success. Are we here, Bazalwane? What is this legacy? It is something that is handed down or remains from a previous generation or time. So our assignment then, it is to, as families, pursue the glory of God. Our assignment, it is to go before the throne of grace and to cry out to God to say, we are not going to live, we are not going to die until you show us the glory. Until you cause us to experience the glory in our family. Because we cannot live and die without leaving a legacy of glory for our children. So, like Moses, we are praying, God, show us the glory. Reveal your glory in our family. So it is our duty, it is our assignment as mothers, as fathers, as parents to kneel down and say, in our generation, Lord, show us your glory. In our generation, Lord, reveal your glory. In our generation, demonstrate your splendor. Beautify us, Lord. Cause your presence to be made manifest. Cause your power to be made manifest. Because if we don't see your power, sizobatshela nabantwana bethu. If we don't experience your presence, sizobatshela nabantwana bethu. If we don't taste your prosperity, sizobatshela nabantwana bethu. What kind of legacy are we going to leave behind for them? But in order for God to continue with this work of displaying his glory from one generation to another, he has got to gain access to our generation. And we have got to be aware, we have got to be conscious, we have got to be sensitive to that fact that God is so much desperate, looking for vessels, looking for families, looking for churches where he can display his glory. He's looking for candidates who are going to say, I am here, Lord. Manje kukhona abantu abaninga ababalekayo. We are praying for the vaccine, which is supposed to be a solution to COVID-19, but yet on the other hand, we are saying, no, we cannot be available in Africa to be used through this process. Yokuchecka whether or not it's going to lento izosebenza. And that is a totally different argument and debate, and we can take it to different directions. But I am here to say to you that if you are going to avail yourself and be able to endure as this generation and say, I'm willing to take that knock, I am willing to allow life to take me through hell. But I know one thing, Lord, that every pain, every suffering, it is working. It is producing my glory. It is producing a glory for my family. And if I've got to confront the demons that my family did not confront, I am going to be the one who is going to confront them. If my father died even before confronting any generational curse, I am the one who is going to rise up. I am the one who is going to take it by the horns. I am the one who is going to possess my possession. I am the one who is going to say, Lord, I am willing to endure. I'm willing to go through it, but I'm going to fight just so my children will not go through the same thing that I have gone through. But if we shrink and we don't pursue the glory, our children will not see the glory. Our children will have to fight for themselves to see the glory. But can we imagine what would have happened to the nation of Israel if Abraham just said, you know, God, forget about me. I'm old. I'm more than, don't trouble me with stretching my faith and causing me to believe. What are you talking about? I'll be a father of many nations. What are you talking about, descendants? Because you know I'm old. You know I can't produce children at this age. You know I can't do it. Can you imagine if what would have happened with the nation or the legacy that God produced from Abraham to Isaac to Jacob to the nation of Israel and to us today? Because today we are regarded, I said earlier, as the children of Abraham because of what Abraham endured. Abraham, he had to stretch himself. He had to believe God, even when his body was disagreeing with him. So that's what we are supposed to be doing today as the men and women of God, as the children of God. We are supposed to be saying, even though the economy does not agree, even though my education does not agree, even though my background does not agree, but I only have faith. I am going to believe in God. I am going to trust God. There's got to be a chain. There's got to be a cycle that I interrupt for the sake of leaving the legacy of glory, because there are children who are waiting for this legacy to take it to the next level. Let me tell you, if we are running a relay race, the very last runner depends on the previous one. And that one depends on the previous one. And if we are going to drop the baton right now and not run our mile, we are going to be, you know, failing the next generation. And we need to be that kind of a generation that says, I'm not going to leave a legacy of death. I am not going to leave behind a legacy of pain and sorrow and brokenness, but I'm going to leave behind a legacy of glory. I'm going to leave behind an inheritance of glory. I want my children to know God. I want my children to grow up knowing God and understanding that God has a plan and a purpose for our lives, that God wants to use us as vessels, that God wants to use us for His glory, that all that God is looking for, He is looking for candidates who are not going to be afraid, candidates who are going to say, "Here, Lord, use me as a trial. I am availing myself for as long as the glory is being produced." Because there can never be glory in any person's life unless you go through pain, unless you go through trouble. Why are you going through such trouble? It's because probably the previous generation did not try to reach higher heights that you are attempting to reach. Maybe they did not dream enough. They did not have, you know, visions enough. But you, unfortunately, you are not just looking at a simple life of just, you know, as long as ngifundile ngathola umsebenzi ngasebenza ngakhindla ngahlala. But you've got dreams and visions that are bothering you from the inside of you, and the devil is trying so hard to suppress that dream, to suppress that vision. He is trying so hard to just bring you down. Why? Because he knows that once you can get or experience that breakthrough, there's something that is going to be interrupted. And I'm telling you, Bazalwane, we need to go beyond the fear. We need to go beyond the intimidation that the devil is bringing before us. We need to say to ourselves, "Devil, I am willing to die fighting. I am willing to go down the grave fighting. But as long as I'm breathing, I am going to fight. I'm not going to give up. I know that you don't want me to live a good life, a better life than this. But I am going to fight. I am going to sweat. I'm going to toil. I'm going to pray. I'm going to fast. I'm going to do everything that the Bible says I must do. I'm going to be a fool and give. I'm going to be a fool and sow seed. I'm going to be a fool and pray. I'm going to be a fool and sing praises to God. I'm going to be a fool and prophesy. I'm going to be a fool and declare. For the sake of the generation that is coming after me, I'm going to try things that were never tried in my family. I'm going to build businesses that were never built in my family. I'm going to pursue education that was never pursued in my family. I'm going to dream dreams that were never dreamt in my family. I'm going to have visions that my family did not have. I'm going to build homes and houses that my family did not even dream about building. I'm going to choose to stay in places that even my family. Why? Because I want to interrupt something. There is a glory that I must produce. There is a glory that I must create. There is a glory. There is a legacy of glory that I must build. The Bible says the wise will inherit glory. What kind of glory will they inherit from us if we don't push beyond boundaries? If we don't say to ourselves, we are not satisfied. We are going to stretch ourselves and walk on thin ice for the sake of creating the glory. We are not going to be enough with one campus at Delmas. We will get into that building that we have to pay thousands and thousands of rands just for us to interrupt the cycle and say, we are building the glory. We are building the legacy of glory. And we are going to say, not only are we going to rent in this building, but we are believing God, just like Abraham, by faith, we will buy it and own it. Why? We are building the legacy of glory, baby. And even in your house, I prophesy and declare, in your home, in your family, there has got to be some element of, you know, that kind of radical faith that stirs you up and say, I'm not going to stay in this flat forever. I cannot be renting forever. Because there is a legacy of glory that I am building. I'm going to build, believe God for a bigger house. I'm going to believe God for millions. I'm going to believe God. Why? Because there is a legacy of glory that I am busy building. I'm not going to settle for anything less. I'm not going to accept the fact that question is cutting. Ushayi 15 inganamali on the account. I'm not going to settle for uguti mang withdraw imali. I'm going to check his sleep with the seller and Amalie. I'm not going to settle for that. I'm not going to settle for applying for things each time. I must buy a home or a car. I must check my credit record. I'm not going to settle for that. But I want to leave a legacy of glory. I'm not going to ask how much because, you know, I want to check affordability. I'm going to ask how much because I want to pay. I'm interested in paying. That is the kind of the legacy we want to leave behind. We want to leave a legacy that will touch a generation and know that if we have God on our side, He will see us through. That if He took our forefathers through the Red Sea and killed Pharaoh and his soldiers, if He was able to produce water out of the rock, if He was able to heal the waters of Meribah, if He was able to heal them after they were bitten by snakes, if He was able to provide manna for them, then why can't we believe for the same God of glory, to do it in our generation, to do it in our time? Because when we hand over the baton, we will sit down with our children and say, look, this God that we serve and this God that we have introduced you to took us from there to there to there. He took us from glory to glory. And we are leaving you this legacy of glory, not just to stay at this level of glory. There is more that can be found in Him, because to His glory there is no end. To His glory there are no limits, there are no boundaries. You can take it and just push it a notch higher. Push it a notch higher. Push it a notch higher. That is the kind of legacy we want to leave behind. So my brother, my sister, you believe in God for marriage. Understand, it's not just for having fun. God wants to touch generations through your family. Are you now currently married? Understand, it's not just about you having fun. There's a legacy of glory that you must build and leave behind for your children and for their children. God wants to use our families. God wants to use our generation to produce glory, splendor, beauty. May people begin to see the glory of God all around because of the things we dared to do. And we said to ourselves, it does not matter whether it was not tried before, but we will go after it. We will do it. We will do it. So I'm gonna like to again, okay, for the sake of the legacy of glory. We'll believe God for things. You see, God did not just save us just so that we can become religious people. God saved us for generations. He says, this promise is not for you, but it is for your children. That is what God says. And if you are watching this service this morning and you are not saved, you are not born again, you are not a child of God, we are challenging you this morning to surrender your life to the Lord Jesus Christ. Be born again today and experience the glory of God in your life. Pray this prayer after me and you are going to be saved and you are going to be born again. And say, Lord Jesus, I thank you today for reaching out to me. I repent for all of my sins. Wash me with your blood. I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that you died for my sins and you rose again. I thank you today for my salvation. I am born again. I'm a child of God and I am filled with your spirit. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. We love you. Thank you again for watching this message. I hope it was a blessing to you. And please do subscribe to our channel and click on that bell so that you can receive all of the notifications whenever we are loading new messages. And if you have been following us and you have fallen in love with what we do here at Builders Church, why don't you become part of the Builders community, especially if you are far away from any of our physical campuses. And I promise you, it's going to be a great journey together. God bless you.